Good morning and welcome to the 28th meeting in 2015 of the Health and Sport Committee. I would ask everyone, as I usually do at this point, to switch off mobile phones and as they often can interfere with the sound system, but also to for our panel and others here this morning to note that members and colleagues may be using tablet devices instead of their hard papers. I have an apology this morning from Rhoda Grant, and we are expecting Jane Baxter to be attending as her substitute. Our first item on the agenda today is subordinate legislation, and we have two negative instruments before us. The first instrument is National Health Service Payments and Remission of Charges, Miscellaneous Amendments, Scotland Regulations 2015, SSI 2015-333. There has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comment on the instrument. Are there any comments from members? I take it there isn't any comments. Can I take from that we are agreed to make no recommendations? Agreed. Thank you. The second instrument before us is Mental Health Tribunal for Scotland Practice and Procedure, Number 2 Amendment Rules 2015, SSI 2015-334. Again, there has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee have not made any comments on the instrument. Do we have any comments from members? Take it we haven't. Do I take from that then that the committee are agreed to make no recommendations? Thank you. That's agreed, thank you. We now move to agenda item number 2, which is our second evidence session on Alcohol Licensing, Public Health and Criminal Justice Scotland Bill. We have Richard Simpson here with us as the member responsible with us, and who will have an opportunity to ask some questions at the end of this session. To feed into the committee's consideration of the bill, I and Colin Kerr, Nanette Millen and Malcolm Chisholm, members of the committee, attended a fact-finding visit yesterday in Newcastle. We met with a range of representatives from the local authority, NHS and police, to learn more about their alcohol watch container marking scheme and the super strength scheme, which deals with super strength drinks. And I would like to take this opportunity to put on record, first of all, for my colleagues who gave up their time yesterday to come to Newcastle, and more importantly, for all of those who gave their time, community police visits, and we were very well received, and we appreciate that very much, and we've found it an informative and useful visit. Can I now welcome to the committee John Lee, Head of Public Affairs, Scottish Grocers Federation, Douglas Frood, Douglas, Chairman, National Licensing Standards Officer Group, Archie MacIver, Licensing Law Subcommittee Convener, Law Society of Scotland, Councillor Cryle Shand, Chair of Central Licensing Boards, Aberdeenshire Council, and Douglas Campbell, Renfrewshire Licensing Board Assistant Manager, Solicitor Licensing. Thank you very, very much for all your attendance here today. As usual with a round table, the politicians around the table are expected to listen a wee bit more rather than questions, although we will move to a question. The panel will be successful if we can get some discussion across the various people here representing different views as expressed in the written evidence. But to get us kicked off, I think, Richard, will you ask the first question?
Thank you, Convener. Can I first of all identify that I was a grocery manager for 14 years, and in particular, I was quite interested in the submission by the Scottish Grocers Federation, and I'll direct my question to John Lee, but hopefully ask other members to come in. In your submission, you put We do not support the majority of the proposals, including the bill, and believe that further changes to the licensing system will only add to the complexity of the existing system. Many of its proposals are either unworkable or come very close to simply duplicating existing legislation. What proposals do you believe are unworkable, and what other members may feel on these proposals?
Thanks for your question, Mr. Lyle. I think I'd just like to focus on one of the key provisions, which was to extend or to develop a national container marking scheme. We had some serious reservations about that. Container marking within a store is very time consuming, it's very onerous. Unfortunately, there isn't the kind of a central way that containers can be marked. It can't be done through the barcode that appears on the product, for example. But the key concern with that, I think, is that that measure is actually ineffective when it comes to dealing with the real issues that we have, such as the proxy purchase of alcohol products. So we felt it was both impractical and really did not deliver any particular benefit to the real and tangible problems that communities face, such as the proxy purchase of alcohol. So that was one of the kind of key things that we felt were unworkable. And some of the provisions to that related to advertising, for example, we felt that they have already been dealt with. There are now quite serious restrictions on how a retailer can promote alcohol within a retail premises. So we felt that overall there was too close an overlap with existing provisions, and some of it, as you say, was indeed unworkable.
We have concerns. Many politicians, councillors.
Time, Richard, but we need
Have concerns about kids or juveniles getting purchasing alcohol, and it's very hard for the police to find out where they got it from. And this proposal would identify a local shop or ensure that we could go back to that shop and say, well, you must have sold it, it's got your mark on it.
The product may have originated in that shop, but it doesn't show how it got into the hands of the young person. I mean, I think there's actually a big issue with young people getting alcohol from their family, parents, older siblings, etc. So it's not an indication that there is any lack of due diligence within the retail premises. Proxy purchase is extremely difficult for a retailer to deal with. We're currently involved in a campaign against proxy purchase in Motherwell and Wishaw. It's been highly successful, particularly because Police Scotland have been very committed to taking action on it. And we've noticed a decline in antisocial behaviour, an increase in arrests and charges for proxy purchase offences. So this issue can only be dealt with by a multi-agency approach, which involves police, social service, housing services, the local community, community safety partnership, and so on. And I'm afraid that container marking is a very blunt and ineffective instrument in trying to combat the issue of proxy purchase.
Do the panel members agree that it's a blunt and ineffective instrument? I don't think all the written evidence reflected that. Mr. MacIver.
I think, to a large extent, the Law Society would be supportive of Mr. Lee's position here. I should say at the outset that the Society is very much behind any measures which will assist Scotland's relationship with alcohol, just to make that absolutely clear. So we're not gainsayers, if I can put it that way. But equally, any measures that have to be introduced or will be introduced have to be effective, enforceable, and have some tangible result. Now, the concern that we have is that the bottle marking scheme would simply set people off on a false trail. At best, it would indicate that at some point the alcohol had been purchased or acquired from a particular set of premises. But that is as far as that would go. If the police or other enforcement agencies come across kids drinking alcohol in the park and trace it back to the shop, well, all they can say is at some point it was acquired at that shop. Was it acquired by their parents and they've pinched it from the house? Was it legally acquired by someone of age who passed it on to the kids? How did it get there? I think that's the highest that achieves. And really, with respect, I think the Society's position is that it doesn't go terribly far to preventing alcohol getting into the hands of underage drinkers.
Douglas Campbell and the Councillor Shand.
Thank you, Convener. I I think the points that have been made by the Federation and by Mr. MacIver are certainly, sorry, MacIver, are certainly demonstrative of some of the limits of how the system can be used. Certainly, Renfrewshire Licensing Board, have given a broad, cautious welcome to some of the provisions. Although we think that any initiative at a national level to deal with proxy purchases and so forth has got to be a step in the right direction. I think Police Scotland may see some benefit in terms of being able to gather intelligence if they're seeing a pattern of alcohol coming from the same premises time and time again. But certainly in terms of specific cases, it may not be enough, as Mr. MacIver has said and the Federation have said, just to say, well, this bottle came from that shop, because clearly that's been purchased by someone with, perhaps on behalf of a young person with which the shop may not have been able to deal with directly, and that would always be a mitigation, if not a line of defence that might be taken at a board meeting or otherwise. But I think certainly I'm aware that our partners in the police have feel that if a pattern is seen to emerge from a premises in terms of alcohol time and time again coming from the same place, then that might be somewhere the police would want to target their resources, and to that extent, I suppose, with some note of caution, we would probably have some sympathy with the aims of this, as with some of the other provisions in the legislation.
Thanks for that. Councillor Sean.
Thanks, Chair. The Licensing Board's view on this was that, like in multi-parks, how do you mark all the contained items within that multi-park? You've also got to think about cans as well as bottles. It would be such an onerous thing for the grocers and such like, and the bulk of the alcohol being bought nowadays is through supermarkets, and I just don't think they've got the infrastructure to deal with crates of 12 cans of lager. How do you mark out individuals? Well, I think it's got to be targeted based. If there's a particular problem, there's a kid's hanging out at a particular point and it seems to be a particular type of drink that they've got, then tracing it through that way, it's a sledgehammer to crack a nut in our view.
That might take us in. I don't know, Malcolm, you indicated you wanted to say something. I don't want you to relate to our visit yesterday, because it's a good point.
The main issue that's been discussed and our visit yesterday, because I think it's probably important just to put on the record. I mean, one of the main things we saw yesterday was the use of the alcohol watch sticker. So I think at least it's part of the debate, whatever people think about it. And the reality is it has been used quite extensively, particularly in the centre of Newcastle. And just in terms of the practicalities, it's not done by the grocer, it's done by the officials of the council in terms of stickers that go on. And we saw the stickers, and they go on quite easily and can't be taken off. So it's certainly possible to do that. It doesn't cost a lot of money either, we were told. And so people can, gain intelligence about where there have been problems. I mean, I think it's obvious that you can't just assume that an underage person has bought the bottle, but I think you can still gain important intelligence from that. And interestingly, a lot of the stores were quite keen to be involved in the scheme. Now, of course, it's a voluntary scheme in Newcastle, which I think is different from what's suggested in the bill. So no one's suggesting it's a panacea, but I think it would be wrong just to rubbish it and say it's not unworkable. It's obviously not perfect and would need to be complemented by other measures, but I think at least people should look at the evidence of where it has been applied and have at least recognised that it possibly does have a contribution to make.
Just as part of that debate, just to, and you'll get a chance to respond, but something as we heard yesterday, it is very targeted. It's targeted not at all drinks within a grocer store. It was, as you suggested, Mr. Shant, certain drinks, whether it be high volume lagers, the white lightning stuff, certain areas. We heard yesterday that it also gave comfort to some staff that worked in, out with the city centre and in outlying areas, that they were being watched. So they averted some of the pressure that was put on them, particularly younger members of staff from maybe youths that they know in the area, or numbers of youth coming into the grocer store, and they felt that gave them a bit of confidence. And it wasn't applied to everybody, and of course it was voluntary. and that was a good principle that they pursued. Of course, it limits their opportunities when it will have been voluntary, because they are open to legal challenge. They haven't been legally challenged up to now, but they are continually open to legal challenge, particularly as you go up the chain, you know. But it's so I just put those reflections in the mix. I had yes, please, Mr. Lee.
Chisholm said something very interesting, if I picked you up correctly, that the markings are actually applied by officials, presumably trading standards or licensing standards officers. I mean, certainly that would take away a lot of the hassle for retailers. But again, I think there's an issue about enforcement. I'm not sure that LSOs or trading standards in Scotland would have the manpower to do that. I think there's been a lot of concern recently about the impact of cuts on those services, and I'm really not sure that they would have the manpower to take that on in any widespread way.
So I think I could see the way that conversation was going there. That was one of my concerns. That obviously Mr. Campbell quite rightly said that when targeted, it's good for information and getting a pattern emerging from that. One of the things that our members would obviously, there's the enforcement side of things. If this was to be a condition of a licence, the physical aspect of checking every can, bottle in a large supermarket or small grocer or whatever would be very difficult for us to do. And if that has been doubled up in terms of us actually applying those in the first place, in the first instance, actually applying the stickers that were marking the bottles, I don't know how that would sit if we were to then try and take a premises to review for breaching a condition or serve a notice for breaching a condition on a licence when it was our officers that actually technically applied the sticker itself.
On the other hand, we saw in our written evidence that the lack of prosecutions for sales and underage drinking, and it's been put as a positive. Now, if we are not confident that we've got the resources to police any of this, and we know from our caseload and others that there are people getting access to alcohol causing antisocial behaviour problems, etc., etc., as well as the health problems, you know, that's already a problem for us, is it not, in terms of the number of and the opportunities to enforce. It's targeted, is it not?
In terms of the enforcement of offences being committed by the police, that would be targeting that. I don't have those figures that the police have.
I think in the written evidence, it's you know, the prosecutions and are down. It's put as a positive. I think it was the Grocers Federation we got some of that information. Yes.
What I'd say, Convener, is I think what we're picking up from the proxy purchase campaign that we're involved in North Lanarkshire is that a problem seems to occur when the police can take very positive action on this, but then the reports tend to get marked by the prosecutor fiscal service as no further proceedings. So I'm not sure that the court system is really taking this seriously, even if the police are. And I don't think there's always a good flow of information back to the police about whether or not these cases have actually been proceeded with.
That's a useful clarification of the written evidence. Yeah, thanks. Dennis was beat you to it, Bob.
Okay.
And then I'll get Mr. Councillor Shandon.
Thank you, Convener, and that's very appropriate because in the evidence it was suggesting that Aberdeenshire Council had trialled a scheme with marking within the Ellen and District area. I'm just wondering how effective that was and why the Council decided to stop actually continuing with this. And perhaps Councillor Shandon could answer that question.
I'd be happy to answer that question, yes. It must have been a scheme before my time, because I didn't actually call this implementation. But, you know, I was thinking that I'm a councillor as well as being a chair of a licensing board, and I'm loath to incur councils on extra expense on a general wide, like, mandatory marking of all bottles. But I'd be content if the legislation was permissive and that LSOs and trading standards or even the police had the ability to mark specific or request of a store or whatever we think a bottle type is a problem that we could maybe get to mark your bottles just to see if we can trace the history or even identify how fast around it, for the time it was purchased to the time it was consumed, because it would hate to be targeted as to deal with a particular problem in a particular area. A general mandatory thing I don't think would work.
Yep. Again, you know, we're at an advantage because we had a fact finder. I don't know if anybody else has taken the time, you know, in this interesting area. We visited Newcastle yesterday, where they've introduced with support minimum pricing in bars, initiatives in and around super sense drinks. You know, there's a lot of initiatives taking place there, rightly or wrongly. They have used their imagination and initiatives, and they can be described as best practice with the cooperation of businesses and grocers. So if any of you haven't been down there, and it's not for us to defend their scheme, but go down and test it. Bob?
That's a really interesting comment, Convener. It maybe shows the strength of a voluntary scheme rather than one compulsion and legislation, from what you've said there. But irrespective of whether this would be a desirable power or not to have, can I ask about the power contained within the legislation? Because my understanding is it would be at the request of police, and it would be for police to decide how the product should be marked. And if licensing boards don't comply with that request, they would have to write to the Chief Constable to explain their reasons for not complying with that request. And I'm just wondering, if this power is to be taken, is it best, would it be, if it's to be taken, would it be best sitting with licensing boards themselves rather than with the police, given the fact that it's licensing boards and local authorities that have to incur the cost and have to deal with enforcement? So I'm just wondering, even if we were to go forward with this, are we maybe starting to unpick who should have the strategic role in relation to the licensing strategy and to implementation and enforcement? So it'd be quite interesting to know any views on that.
Comments on that, Mr. MacIver?
Thank you, Rosa. I think in the Law Society's response, we did comment on this, in fact. And the view that the Law Society takes is that Parliament has entrusted licensing boards to regulate, for want of a better term, the sale and distribution of alcohol. And if the power then to be given to the police to promote the bottle marking scheme, in our view, you're starting to undo the principal fundamentals of the legislation, whereby it's the boards that are in control. It's interesting too that if a request from the police goes forward and the board decide, no, it's not for us, there is then an accountability to the police as to why that should be the case. And I do feel that there would be a danger that the power of boards would be starting to be undermined slightly if the power be given to the boards. That would be the Law Society position.
Members of the panel, you've got a comment on that? Mr. Campbell.
I've got some sympathy with what Mr. MacIver has just said in terms of reasons having to be given automatically to the police, where that's not something that would normally happen throughout the course of the legislation. The only other similar analogy I can think of at all is in relation to, if we don't follow the recommendation of the licensing forum, we have to, I think it's under section 12 of the Act, give an explanation as to that. But this is clearly, you know, another organisation that doesn't have quite the role that the licensing forum has. So I think I'm inclined to agree with Mr. MacIver.
No other responses? Councillor Shand.
I think the licensing board should be the ultimate determinant in what goes on at the within their remit. They are charged with licensing. I think if a police request come in, I think there's a problem here in a particular area, I think most boards would be happy to consent to the police dealing with things that was relating to criminal activity. Because in my board, we have a very good relationship with the police, and they're in and sitting in at all of our board meetings, and we meet them on a regular basis and other matters through police things. So I think cooperation between the board and the police is essential, but it's got to be the board that has the ultimate decision in dealing with alcohol.
Thanks for that. Any other comments from the panel members? No? Colin? Keir.
Thanks. Just a wee bit concerned about what I've just heard, because I don't think in terms of the licensing boards, I think the quote, I don't know if you meant it this way, but consenting to the policing in relation to criminal activity, I would have thought there was no place for the board to be doing that. That's the job of the police. Certainly I wouldn't expect any licensing board to ever come into conflict with the police in that way.
In terms of the use of the bottles and whatever, you know, talking about this thing about the licensing board consenting and all this sort of thing, and I saw it as a bit of a, in terms of yesterday, if the police are looking, they see a problem in any particular area, they were starting to bring in stuff like the bottle labelling and all that to attack something that is in an area with specific types of drinks, everything like that. And I don't really see, if allowing for the fact the police should have that in their toolkit, why would you really need all that much in the way of extra power anyway if they saw it as a part of a criminal activity, when really I don't see licensing boards or licensing committees, having been not in liquor licensing but in other types of licensing in Edinburgh, I would never want to get in the way of the police doing anything about criminal activity. That's not my job, or wouldn't have been my job.
Councillor Shand, going to clarify.
I agree that anything relating to criminal activity, even failure to implement licenses properly, is a police matter. But I think cooperation with a licensing board would be essential, at least to know that was being planned, especially if it's a local authority, it's going to have to put the labels on the bottles. I think any criminal activity will ultimately be a responsibility of the police to enforce, and to and their means of operation is entirely for the police to deal with. But I don't think a licensing board should be excluded from knowing what's going on if it's a problem, because it'll possibly eventually come to a review in front of the licensing board. So of a particular premises, if that was to be what the police were to find. But no, I agree, it is ultimately a police responsibility to enforce the law. Yeah.
The idea of, and it seemed to come across in Newcastle, yeah, that the local authority, licensing authorities, the police, the businesses, for the most part, were all working onto the same script, if you like. But I wouldn't like to see, you know, the non-availability of, say, this tool to the police, just because somebody, say a licensing committee or board, didn't like the idea of almost like losing authority, if you like. Okay.
Okay. Any other aspects of the bill? Any questions from committee members? Dennis?
Thank you, Convener. It's just with regard to licensing of premises and the possible extension to 42 days from the 21 within the planning. And there seems to be some degree of it may be controversy and disagreement. I think the Law Society are content that it remains at 21 days, as is other planning. However, the councils, as in Aberdeenshire, are quite content to see it be extended to 42. I'm just wondering if we could maybe examine that and ask maybe why either support the 21 or the 42 days in terms of the licensing of premises for the consultation period.
Councillor Shand, and then Mr McKee.
The Aberdeenshire, I don't think it's a single policy. I think the North Board's consultation put in for 21. It was the Central Board consultation that came in for 42. And the reason why we were happy with 42 is to allow community councils a chance to sort of consider things, because they often go in a four-week cycle, and 21 days wouldn't allow them to do that. And also that 21 to 42 days didn't seem to be particularly onerous in those who are applying for a license. Another 21 days wasn't going to make much of a difference, in our view. So that was why we were happy to go along with the 42 days as opposed to 21 days.
I think the Law Society position is that we would not be in favour of the extension. One of the difficulties, I suppose, that all parties to the process have is that we all tend to look at our own little areas, and we base our decisions on our own experiences of our areas. And I've not the slightest doubt that in certain parts of the country, applications are processed very quickly. But that is not uniform throughout Scotland. To put that into context, I had a meeting in a major city last week, and of the 19 applications on the agenda, 14 of them had been lodged in excess of 9 months. prior, and indeed some were a good bit more than 9 months. And so already there's a considerable delay in the processing of applications, which in turn can have a major impact on businesses. It can stifle development. I would remind your honours, sorry, members, with respect, I have elevated you to the peerage. That's the problem with appearing in front of licensing boards. One gets your honours in the brain. Members and convener, that under the previous legislation, the 1976 Act, it was only 5 weeks lead-in time from an application being lodged to it being dealt with by a licensing board. And now we're talking about 9 months, a year. Anything that will further that delay is, in the Law Society's view, a bad thing. And from experience of those who sit in the committee who have contributed to the response, certainly we do not find, those of us that are practitioners on a day-to-day basis in this field, do not find that people are slow to object within the 21-day period if they feel the desire and the requirement to do so. 21 days is also the planning lead-in time, as I understand it, for objections. And again, I'm sure those of you with experience in that field will readily accept that people take advantage of that 21-day period and lodge their objections. So we really don't see any reason that would support the increase to 42 days, Your Honours.
Mr. Campbell.
I think in our written response we did reflect that it may mean that some applications may take longer, with the point that Mr. MacIver has just made, and also accept what's been said by the councillor, Councillor Shand, in relation to the community council cycle, and that they can't respond sometimes unless they've had a chance to have their meeting. I think in relation to this stuff, although we haven't really taken a strong, in fact, I think we could understand the reasoning for extending the period to 42 days. As an officer, what would worry me more about the community involvement provisions is the extension of the 4 metres to 50 metres. That is going to have massive implications for, I think, Mr. Frood as an LSO, I'd imagine, perhaps might have a view on that. I'd anticipate that if you have an area where there's not a community council active, and we have such an area, where it's built up, there's loads of tenement flats, and effectively this provision isn't just going to apply to new premises licences. This could be a case of a major variation to increase the capacity of a premises by 2 square metres. That's a major variation. Effectively then somebody has to, you know, notify everyone within a 50-metre radius in what might be a very built-up area. So I think there are potentially huge implications for LSOs in all likelihood to try and administer that system if it was to come in, although I can understand the sentiment behind it and why that might be something that would seem attractive in the face of it, but it could mean LSOs effectively having to have vast amounts of their time taken up trying to implement such a system rather than perhaps trying to deal with enforcement matters that may be beneficial in terms of the licensing system as a whole.
No one else on that? Councillor Shand, and then I think Malcolm, what's the question?
We thought the extension of the distance was excessive and totally onerous and virtually impossible to deal with in a particularly built-up area where you could have high-rise flats. So we thought 50 metres was a nightmare for licensing clerks and LSOs to deal with. We thought it was totally out of proportion.
Okay, Malcolm, Douglas. Okay, he's on my blind side here. Please, just give me a nudge.
It was just in response to what Mr. Campbell said, that there is a great degree of variance across licensing board areas as to how the LSO carries out their duties. And many of our members would have absolutely no involvement with the application process in terms of who is notified, etc. Depending again on your local authority, you may be involved in dealing with representations or objections that come in before they go to the board, because a lot of people will simply object or make a representation while not maybe fully understanding what the application was. So I take on board that it may have an effect on some LSOs, but for a lot of LSOs, it would have. As a group, we didn't make a response to this particular provision.
I appreciate it might not just be LSOs, but certainly somebody would have to deal with the notifications, so there would still be, I think, a resource issue involved.
Malcolm.
Move it on. I mean, I think that was an interesting discussion, although I suppose there are intermediate options between 4 metres and 50. I suppose four does seem a ridiculously small distance. Now, I was interested in the evidence on advertising, because I think it's one of these areas where I think people in general are sympathetic to the intention and so on. But I noticed the Law Society seemed to concentrate mainly on enforceability and feel that it wasn't enforceable, so it would be interesting to hear about that. And the National Licensing Standards Officers Group thought that, again, I think without disagreeing with the principle, that actually it wasn't quite worded in a way that would deliver the intended result. So I was quite interested in those submissions. So I think the whole area of advertising, it would be interesting to hear people's views on it. I suppose particularly from the Law Society, also some reflection on how it relates to current, I think, good practice. I'm not sure whether there's any or much legislation about this at all, but there seem to be a lot of codes of practice and such like, so I just wondered, you know, how it related to that. But it does seem to be an area where there's been a lot of general goodwill towards what's intended, but a lot of questions about the detail, I suppose.
Mr. McKeith.
Yes, I think that's a fair way to sum it, Mr. Chisholm, in the sense that there is goodwill behind it, but perhaps the devil is in the details, as always trotted out in these discussions. The first point I would make is that there is already in force legislation to do with promotions. The Alcohol Etc. Scotland Act 2010 introduced provisions to cover that. And to a large extent, I would suggest that they almost replicate what is being proposed in this bill. So that would, I suppose, raise the question as to whether really we're getting into the realms of duplication here. The second point that follows on from that is that if we were to proceed down what is proposed in the bill, there is a great deal of scope for confusion, I would suggest, in that we have a definition in the legislation already about promotions. We have a different definition in the current proposals regarding advertising. They are similar but not the same, and there's plenty of room there for complete and utter confusion, I would suggest. And where there is confusion, there naturally follows from that difficulties about enforceability. The other aspect which the Law Society's view is founded upon is the difficulties, practical difficulties. If you were to accept 200 metres from the boundary of a school or a creche and so on, what happens, for example, to existing premises when a creche, say, moves into the area? How does the existing business respond to that? There is one aspect which I think I should correct, because it's in my view, on reflection, wrong. We did cite the example of somebody wearing a football jersey turning up at the school gate. I accept that is not a fixed place, so perhaps members could draw a line through that one, unless you've got a very lazy parent who's standing there for days on end. That said, I think there are slightly other aspects to it. We cited the example, and we're not being flippant in any way when I say this, but one does see, for example, coming up to sporting events, youngsters putting posters and windows and things. Scottish Cup final was once, maybe still is for all I know, sponsored by a very well-known drinks company. Technically, that's an advert in a fixed place. Now, I'm not for a second suggesting the police are going to go kicking down the doors, but on the face of it, that would be a criminal offence. So I think there requires to be, at best, a degree of tightening up, if I can put it that way, and at worst, a serious look at whether it's actually required, given the promotions legislation that's already covered within the existing legislation.
Anyone else wish? Mr. Lee?
Thanks, Kevin. I would just echo almost everything Mr. MacIver said there. From the retailer's point of view, the 2010 Act already restricts the promotion of alcohol within the retail premises, and it seems that this provision was just adding more ambiguity to that and was not clear about the differences between promotions and advertising. So there are already very strictly defined restrictions on promotions of alcohol within a store, and I think Mr. MacIver explained the potential problems with all of this very well.
Anyone else? We've had some evidence. Yes, Douglas, what did I tell you? Just
give me that nudge, yes. I think Mr. Chisholm had said about enforcement as well, and really Mr. McKeever's stolen some of thunder in terms of there is legislation there at the moment as brought in by the Alcohol etc. Act, which excludes premises from advertising out with their alcohol display area unless it's 200 metres away. From our point of view, it possibly brings in the notion of trying to find out where these creches, nurseries, playgroups, etc. are and where they may spring up from. And in my experience, there hasn't been a great deal of local premises will advertise out with that area. It tends to be your national, not necessarily retailers, more your providers and manufacturers of alcohol that would be there, and they don't hold premises licences. Although they'd be committing an offence, again, further talking about these offences would be under an authorised officer and not necessarily the police in that respect. So that would be something else that may be brought, depending on the intention of that provision, into our remit.
Mr. Campbell?
If I can just add, I think there's probably a fair bit of common ground in terms of what's been already said by the various people that have spoken today, in terms of perhaps the provision's just been tightened up to ensure that the laws of unintended consequences don't apply and that people aren't unfairly criminalised. We've touched on it in our response, but I think certainly having looked at some of the broader responses that have been made to the committee, there are issues around, is one premises not going to be able to display some sort of placard outside its premises, whereby some other premises 10 metres away might be able to do that because they happen to fall out with the 200 metres from the creche. So you've got some that are advertising, some that aren't. I think it may be a provision that needs to be looked at more closely.
Okay. Anything else on the advertising? But events, portal events, cultural events? No? Bob?
Thanks, Convener. I just kind of want to again move the conversation on, the discussion on, because obviously it's a fairly wide ranging bill. So, drinking banning orders is part of the provisions. I'm interested to get some views on that, perhaps in relation to, again, I was just looking through my briefing there in terms of how that relates with existing legislation in relation to where ASBOs currently exist. I also know that there's a bit of a lack of clarity, maybe, in terms of whether it's on sales, off sales, by postcode definition, certain streets, what would come in the auspices of a drinking banning order and how that might or might not be enforceable. But also I noticed within the legislation that where someone is convicted for an offence where alcohol was part of that offence, from my reading of it, the court would have to give a reason for why they weren't imposing a drinking banning order. I may have got that wrong, but I think that's what the legislation says. So just in terms of how desirable moving towards drinking banning orders would or wouldn't be, how much there's duplication with how the law currently operates or works, and how workable enforcement would be, and whether courts should be driven towards considering a drinking banning order in each case. I know quite a lot in that, but it would be helpful if we could get some comments on that, Convener.
Can we have some comments on that? Councillor Shand.
Thanks, Joe. We were supportive of that, but the banning orders, but it somehow has to be dealt with cautiously, and you know, it does have its downsides, and other problems could arise. But we were generally supportive of the banning orders.
Anyone else? Mr. MacIver?
I think the only comment the Law Society would make is that, again, to some extent, we're moving into the potential realms of duplication here, in that there are already exclusion orders available under the existing legislation. There are the ASBOs that we've heard mentioned in passing that are available. And also, if we understand the position correctly, banning orders would only apply to premises licences for consumption on the premises. Now, the general feedback, I suppose, that we tend to get from the police and the like is that much of the social fallout from the abuse of alcohol is centred on drinking in the home, alcohol obtained from off-sales premises, which would not appear to be covered by the current proposal, if we understand it correctly. So perhaps there's a slight gap there. Although it's not a question really for the Law Society, we did touch on the question of the resources, because as I understand it, it would either be the police or the local authority who would have to seek such an order, and in the current budgetary constraints that everyone's working under, we just wonder whether the financial wherewithal would be there to pursue these particular orders.
Anyone else? No? Any other questions from members?
Mr. MacIver, could you explain? I mean, are the exclusion orders in the 2005 Act and the banning orders, I mean, is there an overlap there, or are you saying they're almost identical? Or?
The exclusion orders, I think the main difference, I suppose, would be that exclusion orders really cover a situation where a person has been convicted of a violent offence. So it's really restricted to violence in or in the vicinity of licensed premises. And I accept that Dr. Simpson's proposal widens that to, I suppose you could class it as antisocial behaviour to some extent. So there is a degree of difference. Whilst I cannot give you statistics, I'm not particularly aware of a huge use being made of exclusion orders. And again, we come back, I suppose, to certain things that were touched on earlier, that the powers may already be there and may not just be being used over much, and whether this would be yet another item in the statute book that is there and is available, but nobody actually uses.
The powers are there and are not being used.
I'm not sure that, I mean, we haven't touched on the matter in the licensing board's response. I don't think it's a matter that I would directly comment on. I think obviously would echo some of the concerns as to if there's duplication and resources, but it's probably not something I would be directly involved in the pursuit of a drink banning order. It may, I think, be a wider local authority matter.
Okay. Councillor Shand.
Thanks. I don't think it's a matter that really affects boards directly. It's really a matter for the police and criminal matters that. I don't think it really affects boards, but we're in favour of it.
Okay. Nanette Millen, please.
It's a different subject. I just wanted to touch on the alcoholic drinks containing caffeine. I did raise this with the police in Newcastle yesterday and was met with a fairly blank look. I don't think they've had any problem with it at all, as far as I can gather. So I just wondered for people here, if there are any concerns about the consumption of things like Buckfast or other caffeinated alcoholic drinks.
Mr. Lee?
This is a good question. In our preparation for the written submission that we submitted to the committee's request for written evidence, we could find no evidence that there was a problem with these type of products. We looked at a report from the European Food Safety Authority panel, which concluded that caffeine is unlikely to mask the subjective perception of alcohol intoxication. And we found several other research papers which suggested the same thing. So in gathering our evidence for our submission, we could find no substantive evidence of a particular problem with these products. And we are uncomfortable with particular products being targeted in this way, or there being mandatory licensing conditions that retailers cannot stock particular products. So we really feel there is simply no sufficient evidence to justify a ban on these drinks. And until that becomes available, this proposal should not be taken forward.
Mr. McKay.
I think the Law Society's position is that perhaps slightly more technical, in that fundamentally the first issue we have is that the level of caffeine, which is to be referred to in the legislation, would not be decided as part of the primary legislation, but would be dealt with by ministers in a subordinate fashion. That, I would suggest, is a difficulty, in that it goes very much to the heart of the question, what is the level of caffeine that we're talking about? We're discussing this in the dark at the present time, and I think there would be a major impact on manufacturers and retailers, depending what that level was set at. And if this route is to be pursued, then I think the first thing that should happen is that the level of caffeine should be stated in the primary legislation. The second aspect I would suggest is that at the present time, as the proposal goes forward, it's ready mixed drinks that are being discussed. Now, let's assume that that is followed through and you're able to buy a container, or you're not able to buy a container of, say, a vodka and an energy drink mixed together, and that's prohibited. There's, of course, nothing to stop on that shelf there a vodka and in that shelf there an energy drink, and somebody to come in, buy one of each and go and effectively mix it themselves thereafter. So whether it would go to the heart of the perceived problem, I don't know. We're not in a position as a society to comment on how great an issue the caffeinated alcoholic drinks, how great an issue it really is. It's interesting to hear Mr. Lee's position, and I believe I'm correct in saying, looking at the last report of the previous evidence session, there was again a suggestion that it was a fairly small percentage of sales that fell into this category. So I'm not sure it's perhaps the huge issue that it might be seen to be.
No one else? Councillor Shand?
Thank you. It's nearly a problem up in the northeast. When I'm in my words here, Buckfast. I couldn't find it on sale in my area anyway, but so the best I could do was go on an encyclopedia site to see how much caffeine there was in it. And apparently, from what I learned, there was brown bottles and green bottles. Irish Republic used brown bottles and UK used green bottles, and the equivalent caffeine was 3 cups of tea. And I just thought, well, it seems to be a sledgehammer to crack a nut that when you've got things like energy drinks, I want to mention any particular brand, because supermarkets now produce the same at a much cheaper rate than the standard brand leader. But I think it's gone things round the wrong road, that there's a social problem with Buckfast in particular areas, and I don't think it would make any difference whether it was caffeine in it or no. I don't think that is why these people that have these problems drink it. I think the sweetness of the drink is probably a bigger attraction, and its ease of consumption than the caffeine content. I think it's a red.
What's a mad drink in Aberdeen?
It used to be.
You know what it is, don't you?
Aye.
Tell me what it is.
It used to be white cider.
There we go.
Which could 3 litres for £2. Do we? But it had never seen an orchard in its life. It's apparently it was made for corn syrup. So they,
I ask you that because I relate back to your question about targeting particular drinks in certain localities.
Yeah,
you know that it could be the white lightning, and it could be and Buckfast in certain areas. I mean, I presume that nobody disagrees that there are, you know, and the focus with current or past legislation that focused on strong tights, that is strong lagers, etc. And other, you know, people target a lot of these drinks because they're very harmful, not just to the individual but the wider. So nobody disagrees that there are certain drinks. If we're tackling some of these antisocial behaviour or indeed health problems, I don't think anybody disagrees that some of these particular drinks need to be targeted in certain initiatives. Are we, Mr. Lee?
I think it very much depends on the product, Convener, but we are uncomfortable with particular products being targeted in this way. I think there's complex reasons why people have particular problems with these products, and banning them as such, or using licensing to effectively ban them, seems like us the wrong way to go about it without very robust and concrete evidence for why these products are causing a problem. So we were very uncomfortable with this proposal. And as I say, particularly when we looked at the evidence, and there didn't seem to be any issue really with caffeine and alcohol. So I think there's a real challenge to the perception that these products are having the kind of the harmful effect that we think they are. As Mr. The Councillor Shan says from Aberdeen, it's maybe got nothing to do with the caffeine at all. So I think we have to take a step back a little bit and try to gather more evidence on this whole issue before we ban particular products.
Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Convener.
You're going to tell us your favourite mad drink, are you?
No. I actually don't have one, but if it would be, it'd probably be a nice French cognac.
There you go.
Can I say, Convener, I'm just wondering if it's not a question of caffeine or whatever. Is it not merely that, or even the product, is it not driven by price for certain people that are actually buying whatever product it is? It's based on what can I get at the cheapest cost, and therefore that's what they're buying. So it has no significant area of caffeine or anything else. It's to do with what can I get at the cheapest price because I want to get drunk or blutered or whatever the term might be, you know.
Right. Councillor Shand, I've got Richard Simpson who's champing at the bit, but he will get his opportunity to come in. I can't take you in to respond to that, Richard, but you'll have your opportunity to do it shortly. Councillor Shand, Mr Lee, and Richard Lyle.
I'm not aware that Buckfast is particularly cheap. For what I remember when the minimum pricing legislation was on the go, that it would have fallen out with that matter. So it's not a particularly cheap drink. So it's no price based then. I would have said the white cider might have been a better buy in Glasgow. It's maybe the cheap skates up in Aberdeenshire. I went to go for the cheap drink.
Funny, it's not the good value up there, that's what they say. Mr Lee.
Just a very brief point, Convener, and just to echo what Councillor Shan, the main product that we tend to talk about in this context is not particularly cheap, and as he says, would not be affected, for example, by minimum unit pricing. And I'm not even sure it's particularly strong. It's probably not as strong as we think it is. I'm sure there are actually much more potent products available. So I think in terms of price and strength, it's probably not the problem that we think it is.
Thanks for that. Richard, you have one final...
One final. Can I move on to the point of notification of offenders GP? Just to get an answer in regard to that. I noticed the submission from Renfrewshire Licensing Board in regard to Mr Campbell. Mr Campbell may want to comment on it, and in regard to an individual's right to privacy and accordingly, whether this, any of this proposal is a public benefit. Would you like to comment on that?
Referring to
the notification of offenders GP in the section 31 offences involving alcohol.
Part of my response, sorry, was
I'll help you if you wish.
I'm just looking through a reference to the GP.
Stated that GPs would no doubt be aware of the patient's state of health as a result of misuse of alcohol. You question whether a provision is necessary in regard to public interference or an individual's right to
privacy. Yeah, so I'm just looking for the paragraph of my response that you're quoting from, paragraph. Okay. I've got it here.
Section 31.
I'm not sure it's my response that's been quoted to me. That's my difficulty.
Well, sorry. It's at the top of you. It says Renfrewshire Licensing Board on it.
It's wrong.
I apologise.
Thank you.
It's been the paper is.
You know, is there a reference to that?
I'm interested to know, Convener, has anyone any views in regards to?
I think, Mr. Mayor, that's helpful to get it on the record, Richard. I think it is referred to in the Law Society's. Mr. McKeever.
Yes, it was the Law Society response that referred to that, Mr. Lyle. Really, it was just a general comment about that we would anticipate that most GPs would already be aware of their patients' state of health in the context of alcohol misuse. And given that there is no requirement for the GP to do anything once the intimation is made, we just questioned whether there was any real public benefit to this provision. There was nothing more dramatic than that. If we give them the information but they choose not to do anything with it, is it worthwhile legislating about? That was really the general thrust of the comment.
Okay, my apologies to Mr Campbell. My papers show heading Renfrewshire Licensing Board.
Yes, okay.
Okay. Not guilty. Anyone else on that one? Councillor Shand.
Thank you, Convener. We were quite happy for notification to the GPs, but we felt there was nothing a GP could actually do with that information once they got it. Personally, I was kind of maybe out of line with my colleagues on the board, and that I felt that it impinged on doctor-patient relationships and confidentiality. I just had my personal reservations that other people saying this chap's got a drink problem. It's something that the patient should be disclosing with the doctor directly. But that was my personal view in this matter.
Plug for what was described as a no-brainer self-financing scheme in Newcastle. You defer half your drink-related fine and attend a four-hour course. and they claim great success for it. So, but linking that issue up, directing them to GPs, etc., etc., and you defer the £90 fine to £45, you attend the course, and the reoffending is quite from those who don't attend the course to those who do is showing significant promise, and it's self-financing, it doesn't cost any money apparently. So, you know, I just recommend it there. Malcolm?
It was important to mention that, but I think that specifically relates to another proposal in the bill about alcohol awareness training as an alternative to fixed penalty fines. So it's a kind of example of what is being proposed, except I think the bill is proposing all the fines waived, whereas obviously Newcastle was proposing half of the fine waived. But it's the same principle, and it seemed to be effective because they produced evidence that those who'd been on the course, there was less reoffending than those who hadn't been.
Any comment on that? No? Anyway, it's on the record now. There's a couple of brief areas, and that is in regards to the proposals around age discrimination and off sales. Does anyone get any comment on that? I think there was, in the written evidence, there was more support for that. So I take it the silence confirms that. Councillor Stirrer,
thank you, Chair, Convener. We didn't think age discrimination should play part of the law at 18 for everything. We weren't happy with 21 for some things.
Do any of us know where any of that has been applied, Mr. Lee, Mr. MacIver?
Yes, I can say in my experience, I've only ever come across this on two occasions, both followed upon premises licence review hearings, where the particular premises in question had failed at least two test purchases, and part of the sanction, for want of a better term, that the board imposed was a restriction on the age at which alcohol could be sold. They have both subsequently been overturned, may I say, and these premises are back to 18 plus.
Full to half. It
was a tool that board thought to implement.
Do you any views, Mr. Lee, on that one? Do you know any of that?
Familiar with that, Convener, but it would seem to make things clearer and more consistent. So, from that point of view, we were happy to support.
And the other one was on the general issues. Just to finish that before I go to Richard, there's the general issues of minimum price for packages containing more than one alcoholic drink. Do we have any views about what the provisions might bring in reducing alcohol consumption? Any views on that, Mr. Campbell?
I think we were supportive as a board towards the idea. Why should there be a restriction on the single can as against four cans and not between four and eight? Not sure it introduces a completely linear pricing model, but I don't think that was the intention. So generally, we've expressed some support for that provision.
Just on that again, we've had you're confident that measure could be enforced, whereas
I think, like all these matters, we obviously have the provision in relation to the single can as opposed to four. So it seems that if there would be a restriction that four cans sold as a package shouldn't be cheaper than four times the single can that forms part of them. It seems a loophole if you simply don't stock the single can. So if we're going to have it at all, it might as well be more coherent. And from that point of view, it would seem to be sensible. Like all these matters, obviously it's a matter of time and resources for licensed standards and officers as others in terms of how that matter would be enforced and how proactively it would be enforced as opposed to other priorities. But I think the logic of it does seem to make some sense to us as a board.
And then Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. We were happy with the multiple pack rules, but the mixed packs would always be a way around it if they didn't put things in like for like. If they wanted to find a way around it, I think they can find a way around it. But we were happy with the general principle.
I'm not going to go to Mr. MacIver at this point, but I'm going to go to Douglas.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I agree completely. The Licensing Standards Officers Group was broadly supportive of this measure. It's something that has been lacking from their responsible promotions when they came in, the fact that there's no link between a four pack and an eight pack if that single can's there. And as we commented adversely, the previous change to legislation actually forced the smaller single can off the shelf. So you now have the larger pint tin on the shelf as being the smallest amount of alcohol available to somebody looking to purchase. And because it's part of and could be implemented under Schedule 3, there's no real issues that we see. And obviously, with the detail and the workarounds that may come from the trade, we can't really see a great deal of problems with that as proposed.
Okay. Thanks for that. I think the final one, Mike.
Thank you, Convener. And representing the Highlands and Islands, I feel bound to ask this general question. And I wonder if our witnesses, guests here this morning would exercise their imagination to the extent of considering whether this bill would have a detrimental effect. And what I'm thinking about in rural areas, and what I'm thinking about are the small village shops. Often there are post offices as well. Often they teeter on the brink of viability. Whether the burden imposed by this legislation could mean the difference between viability for those small community facilities.
Mr. Lee.
It's a good point Mr. McKenzie raises, Convener. I don't have the full answer, but I would simply say that our understanding is that there have been six major pieces of alcohol legislation. Oh, sorry, if this bill is enacted, it will be the sixth major piece of alcohol legislation enacted since 2009. I think the retailer's view is that the landscape for licensing has become increasingly complex, increasingly difficult to understand in store. As a trade association, we try to issue guidance anytime new legislation appears to ensure that our members are compliant and selling alcohol responsibly. That can be expensive and time-consuming. So I think it's becoming increasingly difficult for all the key stakeholders to fully get to grips with the complexity of licensed legislation in terms of promotion and advertising and so on. Training is another particular issue. All staff have to undergo 2 hours mandatory training now in Scotland before they can serve alcohol. Premises have to have a premises licence holder and so on. So it is becoming increasingly complex. And I think there is a case for the Parliament perhaps taking a step back and trying to evaluate the impact of existing legislation before we go any further and enact yet another piece of licensing law.
Anyone else, Councillor Shand?
Yes, Convener. As a licensing board, it covers vast rural areas as well as towns. I appreciate entirely what you're saying, but I think the remote village shops and the country pubs, I think their financial situations to be dealt with in a different way. But I don't think that we should be excessively onerous in our legislation. The licensing legislation has now got very complicated, very complex. It's over a whole series of different pieces of legislation. It's just unfortunate there's not a single act that you can refer to where everything is in. It's now amendments to 2005 Act here, and it's got so piecemeal that it probably needs a total reappraisal again. It's a single act, but that's not where we are at the moment. We're dealing with diverse legislation, but I understand exactly your point.
Mr. Campbell, I'm getting the responses, Mike, for your question.
Thanks, Convener. I think just what's been said by both Councillor Shand and also by the Federation today, I think that's a view that's widely shared, that if we could have the legislation effectively under one roof in a consolidating act at some point, it would be hugely helpful. We now have well over 30 sets of regulations. We have, I can't remember if it's the 5th or the 6th Act, including the 2005 Act, but we certainly have the Criminal Justice Act, the Alcohol Act, the 2005 Act itself. We had the Air Weapons and Licensing Act, which of course hasn't in the main commenced yet. So it's becoming a very complex landscape, and I do feel the pain of the trade and the Federation's members in keeping track of matters. It's difficult enough for all the licensing lawyers across the country.
Yeah, I'm just going to echo
that, Mr. Chairman. I mean, we all know the old adage, ignorance of the law is no defence. Well, that's fine if the law is easily accessible, but it's impossible now, being quite candid about it, for the average retailer to keep up with the amount of legislation and regulation that governs this trade. Practitioners who do this on a day-in, day-out basis, we struggle to keep up with it. And the chap who's trying to run his local corner shop or the big high street supermarket, doesn't matter. Trying to find the legislation now is bordering on the impossible. And really, it's a real cry from the heart, if you have any power in this regard.
You understand that the Scottish Government has got support of the Parliament tackling, you know, one of our biggest problems.
Oh, absolutely, but it's the finding of the legislation for the operator that's the difficulty, Your Honour. If it could be under one consolidated piece of legislation, that would make such a difference.
Mike?
No, thank you, Convener, but I think that was a very important point, and that was the one I was seeking to tease out, the need for consolidation. So
yeah, I think it was reflected in the written evidence.
No further questions.
It was reflected in the written evidence. Bob?
Just very briefly, because Mr. Lees talked about we should look to see how successful existing legislation's been. One of the things I think we do have evidence for is the multi-pack discount restrictions that the Scottish Government brought in has already saw a fall in consumption. So there's very strong evidence that exists that that has happened. Would it not, in terms of consolidation, would Dr. Simpson's proposals not actually simplify things? Because if there's already restrictions on multi-pack sales, if you keep it simplistic and you say one can and you add a multiplier so there are no multi-pack discounts, I can't see how that complicates matters for the trade. Surely it actually simplifies it. But I do take on board the point you're making about having all the legislation that impacts on the trade in the one place. But surely this could be argued as actually simplifying it for the retailer, not making it more complex.
Any responses on that one? Yes, sorry, Mr. Lee.
No, that's okay. Thank you, Convener. I think overall, Mr. Doris, yeah, we're just seeing a constant raft of licensed legislation, and it's very difficult for retailers to get to grips with it. Our concern about the multi-back promotion thing was that it might have the inadvertent consequence of forcing people to uptrade. It's no longer really viable for retailers to offer single cans for sale, for example, so customers may just keep buying 4, 8, 10, 12 packs of beer, although, as you say, the evidence seems to be that consumption is actually declining. So we were just concerned that a lot of the provisions in this bill we felt needed clarity, were slightly ambiguous and overlapped too much with existing provisions. So I don't think it would do any harm to kind of pause, particularly with this particular bill, and perhaps review it at some further stage.
Okay. Permission, I'm going to move now to Richard Simpson to allow him a few questions before we finish this session.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Richard.
Can I first of all thank all the witnesses, because the written evidence and the commentary has been very helpful. The central tenet of my bill is that we deal with the very serious offenders very well, and that's the current legislation. And most of what I'm proposing, actually, on the justice side at least, is to try and move this into the area of dealing with the people with a lesser offence. So the DBO, for example, is designed not to deal with the violent offender, but to deal with those who the police identify and the prosecution identify as having probably repeated offences. So I just wonder whether Mr. MacIver particularly feels that the law currently deals with these, whether there's anything that requires the court at the moment to actually make a commentary on repeated offenders who are receiving minimal intervention by the courts. There's nothing there at the moment.
There are the powers that we touched on in terms of the exclusion orders and the like, and as I say, our feedback is that they're not being terribly actively followed up. Now, if that is the case with, if I can use your term, the more serious offender, then it does beg the question, if they're not doing it for the more serious ones, are they likely to go down the road of banning orders for what might be perceived as the less serious offender? So there is that question mark over whether, although it's undoubtedly perfectly laudable aim, whether in practice it would actually be enforced. Now, I can't answer that because that's a matter for the courts, it's a matter for the police, it's a matter for the local authorities. But I think as a society we have reservations that it may sit in the statute book if it ultimately becomes a law and gather dust, as it were.
It's more designed to, if I can just comment on that, it's like more like the drug courts or the DTTOs, where actually the courts get involved more in the management of the case. Can I say on the issue of the multi-pack, which we've just discussed, whether anyone here disagrees with the fact, with the principle that the Parliament supported in its legislation, that volume discounting in Scotland should be banned? Because this is just designed to tighten that up. I mean, the particularly supermarkets have got round this by not selling single cans and saying that 4, 8, 12, 20 are all different and therefore can be sold effectively, getting round the principle of volume discounting. But I'd just like to have it on the record if anyone thinks that volume discounting shouldn't be banned in Scotland. Okay, that's very helpful. On the question of caffeine, Mr. MacIver, the problem there is, I think, that and became clear in evidence from Mr. Lee, that the evidence is actually mainly American-based, the stuff about wide-awake drunks and taking risks in driving, taking risks, sexual risks, being more likely to be both predatory and to be responsive, are evident, very clear in America, but it's mainly amongst college students. The reason for putting it not in primary legislation but secondary was to allow the government to introduce that as the evidence becomes more clear. If you put in a fixed amount, then it's more difficult to change because it's primary legislation. Is that a valid?
I can understand the rationale behind what's being said. I still think, though, it's so fundamental to the question that to enable proper debate to be had on the proposal, that really there has to be an indication in the primary legislation of what that level of caffeine that we're talking about would be. To leave it to be promulgated by secondary legislation would not afford those involved in the production of the retail of these products the same amount of input in my submission, and that, I think that's the danger.
So it would need to be affirmative rather than
I
rather
would suggest negative. So, Your Honour.
Yeah, okay. On the question of the advertising ban, at the moment there's a voluntary ban for 100 metres, and we know that's been evaded in some cases. Do people feel that the 200 metres is a reasonable distance? It's to try and denormalise alcohol in respect of children. No?
Still have the 200, sorry, through you, Mr. Keane. We still have the 200 metre anti-promotion legislation.
It was to bring it into line with it.
That's there already. So again, I suppose I'm just really coming back to, is there an element of duplication? That's the point.
So you make advertising as well as promotions, because yeah, they are different things. I think I take the point, Convener, about the in-store advertising, and I think we'll look at Section 8 again. So I think we need to look at that again. I don't think we've got that quite right. On the question of consultation, this was based on the New Zealand system, which requires far more intensive consultation with communities than we actually have at the present time. If people feel that 50 metres, and I take the point that Councillor Shand and others, I think Douglas Campbell was making in respect of if it was multi-storey blocks, it would be quite onerous to have this. But at the moment, it's 4 metres. If you don't have a community council, and that's predominantly in deprived areas, then you know, the consultation is very narrowed. Would you think, you know, there would be some compromise somewhere between 4 and 50 metres that might be worth amending to?
Thanks, Dr. Simpson. I suppose in any level, certainly a shorter distance would be better than 50. But I'm conscious that there could be cases potentially where, you know, if you're within the vicinity of multi-storey blocks and so forth, then it could still be, you know, fairly onerous. It depends what the distance was. Again, I think it's, again, we're talking perhaps in loose terms without knowing exactly what might be proposed. But certainly at 50 metres, there's one area where, as I say, a small major variation application to slightly increase the capacity of an off-licence premises, for instance, could end up in, you know, How many letters have been delivered, I don't know, but it could be a substantial amount of work for local authorities, and potentially I'm not clear how many responses would ultimately come in and whether the benefit gained by that would necessarily be proportionate to the amount of resources that would be spent on it, which would take away from other priorities.
Yeah. It's only in the 15% where there are no community councils active, of course, so it is limited.
But I've had some consideration of this, and I think there'd be one area where, you know, if we were to have a major variation application, you know, it could be certainly at the moment it could be a very substantial amount of work if there was to be, you know, if the change was to be brought in. So I appreciate that it would only be where the community council is inactive, but nonetheless. There could still be a community council lacking in one of those particular areas and cause a great deal of work for perhaps not such a great reward. But understand the principle of what you're trying to achieve and the benefits of community empowerment in more general terms.
Yes.
Okay. You responded, yeah.
I can see your intentions, but the onerous nature of trying to inform so many people that a major variation might be possible to distinguish between a new premises establishing a provisional license as opposed to a major variation on an existing license. Might be different criteria involved in that in order to mitigate the worst effects of having to inform possibly dozens of people and maybe just an extra shelf space might be deemed a major variation in a local supermarket, you know. But where it's a new premises, maybe a wider distance might be justified, but I think it's the problems attaching to licensing clerks to notify people that this is coming in, I think it's maybe just a burden too far.
Okay, thank you for that. And my last one, Convener, is on bottle marking, which was where we started our discussion today. I think the critical things here are that it's focused on specific stores, and it's actually designed to protect stores as much as to actually seek to punish stores, because there's evidence actually that from some of the stuff that I looked at, that stores that were thought to be selling underage, for example, it was discovered after marking that they weren't the ones. So it was about gathering intelligence, focusing on stores, so it's not a large number of stores. It's not a national scheme in that respect. It's not saying to all stores you'll be required to do it. It's focused on, should be focused on specific drinks. I think that's a very important point that's come out today. And the other thing is that it should be temporary. So it's not an ongoing thing. It's designed to allow the police to gather intelligence. And the purpose is that we've had hardly any prosecutions for proxy purchasing, because it is extremely difficult. It's almost impossible for the retailer to actually know that they're selling to someone who's then going to hand it on. So it's to actually gather police intelligence. Now, I understand there are going to be some costs involved, obviously, and working out who's going to do it precisely is obviously a matter for discussion and regulation. But is the general feeling that this is a useful tool for police to gather intelligence, even if it does require some temporary imposition on stores? Or is the feeling still that, is there a feeling that this is a step too far? Because proxy purchasing is one of our biggest problems and has not yet been, there has really been almost no prosecutions on that. That's because it's so difficult.
Mr. Lee?
We're still not convinced that this is really an effective way of dealing with proxy purchase. As I mentioned earlier, there does seem to be a problem with, even when police take very positive action on this, arrest people and charge them, the reports are passed to procurator fiscals, they tend not to be marked for court action. So there seems to be a problem there as much as anything. I think this problem can only be solved, as I said earlier, with police working with retailers, working with social services, working with youth and diversionary services, working with housing, really to get to grips with this problem, because it is a complex issue. A lot of the time, the people who are involved in proxy purchase are people who have problems with addiction themselves and need very short injections of cash. That's why they're willing to do it. It's not something a responsible person would do. So, and unfortunately, the other scenario is that it's people who want to cause some harm to children and young people who are willing to do it. So I think it's a very complex issue, and I'm still not convinced that the bottle marking scheme is the right way to do it. Although I do have sympathy with, if it's a voluntary scheme, has been worked out between the police and the retailers, then perhaps we could look at it. But in terms of a national mandated scheme, I don't think that's something we could support.
Just one final question.
I don't know if there's any other comments. No, we're okay with that. Councillor Shan.
Thanks, Convener. I was going to make a comment about the proxy purchase sort of implies that an adult is deliberately buying an alcoholic drink for someone who is underage for a specific occasion. I imagine that most proxy purchases would have been done inadvertently, and the parents would come home with a trolley, a supermarket drink, and the children would help themselves, and either unbeknown to the parents or with the connivance of the parents, so just help yourself to that bottle or that case and off you go. I think it's not a particularly easy thing to enforce or deal with. I think a vast majority will be inadvertent proxy purchases rather than deliberate proxy purchases.
Okay.
Yes, I think my final comment would be I would expect that the police, before doing this, would actually be talking to the licence holders, because they don't want a bad relationship with them. The information we got on the Dundee project was it just was so cumbersome when it wasn't actually a regulation that was allowed to be imposed. This gives the power to the police if they feel it's necessary. But if they don't feel it's necessary and they can do it on a voluntary basis, that's absolutely fine.
Okay. Can I thank you all for your participation here today, your attendance and your valuable time you've given to the committee. Very helpful. Thank you very much indeed. We now go into private session, as previously agreed, to deal with the remainder of our agenda. Thanks very much.